Segment, we're going to talk about quadratic spline interpolation. So I'm just going to talk about the theory and background of quadratic spline interpolation in this segment. An example will be shown in a separate segment. So let's just talk about the background, or some people might call it the theory or something like that. Now, let's go and see what the motivation behind quadratic spline interpolation is. Now, what is it? What is interpolation itself? Is that somebody is giving you data points. So let's suppose somebody gives you data points like this and says, hey, what I want you to do is I want you to do some interpolation to it. And before quadratic spline interpolation is discussed, we talk about something called linear spline interpolation. So you have y versus x data given to you. In the linear spline interpolation, you will simply draw straight lines going from one point to another. That's what you're doing. That's all you're doing. So you are just simply drawing straight, connecting the dots by using straight lines. And as we observed in the linear spline interpolation, one of the problems is that there are two issues here. One is that the only information which you are using in order to be able to do the interpolation is two consecutive data points. That means that, for example, when you are drawing this linear straight line, you're not using any information from these other data points, because in order to be able to draw a straight line, you just need the information from two data points. The other one is that you are getting discontinuous slope at the interior data points right there, because you are, just by looking at this graph, you can see that the slope is changing as you go to the left of the point, to the right of the point. And that is a phenomena which you are introducing, a numerical phenomena which you're introducing, as opposed to it being a physical phenomena. So the answer to this question might be to use quadratic spline interpolants, because it's quite possible that we might be able to answer the question that, hey, we can use the information from other data points, and also that we won't get the problem of this slope suddenly changing from to the left of the point to the right of the point. So let's go and describe the problem statement. So what we have is that somebody is, somebody says, given x naught, y naught, all the way up to x of n, y of n, and says conduct quadratic spline interpolation. Conduct quadratic spline interpolation. So what that means is that somebody is giving you n plus 1 data points, and what they want you to do is they want you to develop quadratic splines through the data. So let's go ahead and illustrate this in a plot. So let's suppose we're given y is a function of x. So, and what we're going to do is we're going to show these points. We have x naught, y naught, and then we have x1, y1, then we have x2, y2, let's suppose. And then let's suppose we have x of n minus 1, y of n minus 1. So this is the last but one data point. And then we have another data point, x of n, y of n. And what you're finding out here is that all the x values are in some kind of an ascending order. So if the data is not given to you in that particular form, you do have to sort it out to put it in that particular form. Now, in the linear spline interpolant, what we did was we simply drew a straight line from one point to another. In the quadratic spline interpolant, what we're going to do is we're going to just simply draw a second order polynomial going through consecutive data points. That's the only difference. So what that means is that let's suppose if we have this first quadratic spline here, this quadratic spline will be, let's call it a1x squared plus b1x plus c1. That's what we're going to be assuming, which is the quadratic polynomial going through the first data point, two data points. Now, through the second, we'll have a2x squared plus b2x plus c2. Going through the second and the third data point, and so on and so forth. And the last one, what we'll have is that we'll have anx squared plus bnx plus cn. So what you're finding out is that through two consecutive data points, you have a quadratic spline or a quadratic polynomial going through two consecutive data points. So you have n plus 1 data points. That's already given to us, because our data points are starting from x naught, y naught, all the way up to x of n, y of n. So we have n plus 1 data points. And how many splines do we have? We have n splines, okay? Because we have one spline going to the first and the second data point, then another spline going to the second and third data point, and the last spline going through the last two data points. So we have n splines. But in each spline, each quadratic spline, what you are seeing here is that we have three unknowns. We have three unknowns for each spline, so that means that we have three unknowns. So we have to find out what the unknowns for each of the splines are. These coefficients of the second order polynomial, A1, B1, C1, A2, B2, C2, A sub n, B sub n, C sub n, they're all unknowns. And what we're finding out, in each spline there are three unknowns, so we have three unknowns. So what we've got to do is we've got to set up three unequations. Because if we have three unknowns, we need to solve up three n simultaneous linear equations so that we can find out those three unknowns. And once we have those three unknowns found, we can then use our knowledge of these A's and B's and C's which we are calculating to be able to calculate the value of the function at any other point which is of interest to us. And that's what interpolation is all about. That somebody gives you the values of the function at certain data points, and you want to find the value of the function at some other data point, at some other point which is not given to you. So that is the bottom line of this whole theory about the quadratic splines, that you have n plus 1 data points, you have n splines, 3 n unknowns, and we have to set up 3 n equations. So let's go ahead and see how we can set up these 3 n equations. Now, the first thing which you have to realize is that each spline is going through two consecutive data points. So let me draw it right here. Let me just write down it first here. So the set of 3 n equations which you're going to do, which you're going to get, is part of that is going to come from this observation that each spline goes through two consecutive data points. So if you have each spline going through two consecutive data points, I'm going to draw this again just for purpose of illustration. So I'm just going to show you, let's suppose, these data points are here. So here I have a sub 1 x squared plus b sub 1 x plus c sub 1. So here I have x naught comma y naught, and here I have x 1 comma y sub 1. So those are the data points which I have. So I can very well see that this particular spline is going through these two consecutive data points. That means that a sub 1 x naught squared plus b sub 1 x naught plus c sub 1 should be equal to y naught. As simple as that. Okay, because and then the same thing here, a sub 1 x 1 squared plus b sub 1 x 1 plus c sub 1 is equal to y sub 1. Because this spline here is also going through this particular data point. So what you're finding out is that since each spline is going through two consecutive data points, so what you're going to find out is that you have 2n equations which are going to come out of this. Because we have n splines, and each spline is going through two consecutive data points, you're going to set up 2n equations like that one. So let's suppose if this was, if I'm going to write a general formula, if this was x of I minus 1 and y sub I minus 1, and this is x of I and this is y sub I, for example, then what I'm going to get is that, hey, I'll have this particular spline will be a sub I x squared plus b sub I x plus c sub I. So I'm just taking a general point, I sub minus 1 and I there. So in that case, I'll get a sub I x I minus 1 squared plus b sub I x of I minus 1 plus c sub I will be equal to y sub I minus 1. And then I have a sub I x I squared plus b sub I x of I plus c sub I will be equal to y sub I. Because as I said, each spline has to go through two consecutive data points. And this is saying that, hey, it is going through x of I minus 1. And this is saying it's going through x of I. And I know that this will be I will be going from 1 to n. And that's where the 2n equations are going to come from. So I will take any value from 1 to n. In fact, if you put I equal to 1, you get this set of equations which I just showed you there. So that's where the 2n equations are going to come from. So if we have 2n equations now already taken care of, that means that we needed 3n equations. We already have 2n equations, so n more equations are needed. So we need n equations again to be able to set up the 3n equations. So where am I going to get these n equations from?